The following is a presentation of the Black Hollywood Live Network, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African-American entertainment, Hollywood Redefined. From Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is Black Hollywood Live, Reality Check, featuring in-depth interviews with today's reality TV stars. Black Hollywood Live, Hollywood Redefined.
You're listening to Black Hollywood Live.
And now, the host of Black Hollywood Live, Reality Check.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Black Hollywood Live Reality Check, where we check in with your favorite reality stars. I am your host, Ashley Gray. Joined with me are Corrinne Williams.
Ow, ow.
Michelle Renee.
Hey, guys.
And you know her from LA hair, Miss China Upshaw.
Woo!
Now, she, you know, we got to be nice to her, girls, because I don't know, she ain't feeling this too much, but by the end of this interview, I guarantee that she will be our best friend. Before we get into our segment today, we are going to play a little game. We want China, since she is an expert in the area of hair, we want her to rate our hair
one to ten.
So, Miss China, starting with Michelle Renee, from 1 to 10, what do you give her? Look at them roots, girl. Look at them edges.
Look at them in designer central edges.
Add a little bit of buttercup smile.
That's okay, girl.
1 to 10.
1 to 10. I would say a 7.
Okay, that's good.
Okay, that's good.
I like wearing my hair like that when I was little. So that was
what I was. Was
If I had hair, I would
totally still wear it like
okay.
All right, I'll take a seven.
Okay, so I'll go ahead and throw myself under the bus. China, 1 to 10. Oh, Jesus, let me turn this way.
Don't turn that way. Don't do it. Turn towards her. Let her see that beat face.
No!
6.
Okay, I'll take that.
I would say 6.
I'll take that. See, Michelle, you're beating me.
Only because I feel like hair should move.
Yeah.
And if it's long, you should be able to throw it. You should be able to hit somebody in the face and
hurt them with it.
And so yours is just kind of
a little bit.
But if it has some movement and motion and weight, oh yeah.
Okay. Okay. So obviously we have some movement over in this area. So what would you give Miss Corrinne, 1 to 10?
I would give her an 8.5.
Winning.
I like the highlights. They're very sun-kissed for summer. Yeah. It has movement. Yeah. It looks natural.
Thanks.
It looks clean and done. But not like, oh my God, I just got my hair done. But yeah.
Thanks, okay. China. Boo boo, she's my favorite.
Thanks.
Well, you guys can rate my hair. Look.
Okay, let's see.
I love a natural, so I'm giving you a 9.
Yes. So I love a natural, I do, and I'm not going to say no shade, I would say 7.
Okay.
A 7.
It's shaped all nice.
No, I love it. I love
it
natural.
Like it has moisture.
First of all, this is my rate. I mean, it's your turn now.
Really?
Your turn.
This curl pattern, honey. I just wear a fro under all this glory, so I know what's up. Your turn, Shell. Yes, darling. She's nervous.
No, it looks good on you. I would never do it because my face is too big, but I think it's very becoming.
What do you mean your face is too big?
I have like a big ass head. Like my face head combination is huge.
Look at my forehead though. I'm all forehead.
Yeah. Girl, but it's very becoming on you because of your cheekbones and everything.
Well, okay. Girl, you're working
that.
You're working
that. I'll take that.
My face is a little more round, so that's what I'm saying. It's very becoming on you. 7.
Corrinne.
Okay,
let's go.
Oh, she's
said already.
Sorry. Oh, you said it already?
Yeah.
Oh, my bad. Sorry.
She's lost her mind, everyone.
All right, I'm sorry for the snaps. We're going to go ahead and get into our hot topics. Yes, Corrinne, honey. Let's start with number 1.
Ooh, Chris Brown. Is he a prophet?
Is he?
Okay, well, let's see. Dr. Jamal H. Bryant, pastor of the Empowerment Temple in Baltimore, Maryland, shared a prophetic word with his congregation this past Sunday. In a sermon entitled, "I Am My Enemy's Worst Nightmare," Pastor Bryant used the lyrics from Chris Brown's hit song and my smash hit, "These Holes Ain't Loyal." Ooh, excuse me. The song titled "Loyal," and he preached to his congregation, "These Holes Ain't Loyal." Watch the clip and tell me what you guys think.
Elbow another sister, he should have listened. Every brother would you tap another brother and say, I should have listened to her?
I should have listened to her.
God help me. Old saints, y'all forgive me. But I got to tell you, these hoes ain't loyal. Oh, you got to find somebody. My God.
Yes. And they shouting. They're shouting. Holy Ghost has touched them.
Where is this place?
In Baltimore, Maryland. That's exactly why. It's in Baltimore. Okay.
All right, Phil, that's good. Thank you so much, Phil. Okay, so before we get into it more in the story, News One is reporting that Brian's sermon was filled with homophobia, sexism, and misogyny. News One also states that in the full sermon, Bryant had a few more choice words for baby mamas and sanctified sissies in the audience. And for more of the story, and if you want to see the full sermon, you can go to straightfromthea.com or news1.com and watch the full sermon. I would never attend a church where a pastor is using Chris Brown's song, Loyal, and saying these hoes ain't loyal in a church congregation.
For reference.
And then you will not knock me out with the Holy Ghost, because I might break out into a twerk session, because that's my jam. Like, I just can't. So what do you guys think about... about
totally,
this, trying to
say,
win.
Yeah, check out my dance too.
Right.
But yeah, the hoes part is, I mean, is it the Chris Brown quote or the fact that he said hoes
in church
to the congregation and they applauded him?
Girl, all of the above.
I think it's the fact that he said hoes, because a lot of ministers who are a little bit younger, they do use like secular verses to kind of like connect with a younger audience. So that I do understand. I've been in congregations where ministers did that, but cursing,
girl,
saying hoes.
But you saw in the clip that audience looked like they were mid 40s to upper 60s.
Yeah, but they still, that doesn't mean that they don't listen to the lyrics. I think that looking at the minister, he's not a lot older, so I feel like using Chris Brown's lyrics or whatever was not as inappropriate as you're making it seem, but saying like,
is she coming for me?
I did. I came.
Is she
I just think I agree. I think
out?
He knows.
Right. I ain't come. I'm knocking at the door. I let myself in and sat on her couch. Okay.
Well, let me put my size 9 back through the door, ma'am. it is inappropriate. You know, there is a time and a place for everything, especially when you're going to the house of the Lord to worship. And I just think that, yes, he definitely was trying to convey a message, but he could have used different words to, you know, make his point be known to the congregation. And now everyone in social media and in the world is in an uproar because of this. And you know, he's going on all these, radio shows and what have you, talking about, well, you need to watch the full version because that's not really what I meant. And he just sounds really ridiculous. And he knows better. He knows better than this.
I think he knows that he has a church where, just by the looks of things, mm-hmm. there's a bunch of ratchet people that go to the club on Saturday and are in service on Sunday. And so I think he was trying to appeal to them by referencing a Chris Brown song. You see how they got up.
Girl.
And they got hype.
And reminding them about the song they probably partied together to the night before.
Yeah.
No, not together to that they drove into the church parking lot. Bumping. Holla. Okay, some notable facts about Pastor Jamal. He had a real messy divorce last year due to his infidelity issues.
These hoes ain't loyal.
Come on,
hello.
Now. Yes.
Yeah, so, amen.
Pastor Jamal?
Yeah. The man who just...
Pastor Jamal.
Okay, Jamal. China's lost in the sauce, yeah. So I don't know. Okay, but I mean, if you guys don't have anything else to say, I'm just over the whole
thing. I think
thing.
The most people that sing these hoes ain't loyal, everyone that's like, this is my jam, are hoes that aren't loyal. Have y'all ever noticed that dudes are always like, this is
not
my
true.
Song.
That's my jam.
That's true.
I wasn't
I'm
trying to call
a hoe,
you.
And I'm loyal.
So they I didn't, say.
Oh, she is.
A kid dog will holler.
It's the truth. It's a little arrogant of him, but it's the truth.
I love this
song. I just feel like a lot of dudes sing it, and they quick to get hype when it comes on in the club, and it's like, wait. I mean, Chris Brown made the song, and it's like, you have a girlfriend that's been sitting here supporting you while you've been in jail, and you...
Oh, she's coming for you.
I mean,
all
I'm not, but
brokies.
It's just like the song in general, I think, is a little hypocritical. So well, whether a pastor sang it or some club
I don't think the song's
rat.
Hypocritical. I know. I think that song is real.
And I like it, and I use the phrase often.
Think about
it. And that is exactly why I feel like the pastor included it in his sermon. Now, the way that he, used it was not necessarily correct, but I feel like the reference was appropriate.
Mm-hmm. He should have said girls.
He could have said girls or guys, or just like, he like could have also said, like, you know, referencing the song Chris Brown, you know how it goes. These ain't loyal, so. Yeah.
These folks ain't loyal. Cause
I like folks. A pastor that can kind of connect with a younger audience, because that I'm a younger person and I like that. So I appreciate where he was going with it, but I do understand where you're coming from, but whatever.
I am so thankful that my pastor does not say that.
Whatever.
Thanks. Please. Hallelujah. But I do on Saturday night.
See you Saturday.
He's Jose Loya. So, anyways, in our next story, Pharrell's LUK cover sparks not happy controversy. Pharrell is being accused of cultural insensitivity after the unveiling of the controversial July 2014 LUK cover, featuring an image of the superstar wearing a Native American headdress. So basically, I'm not even going to finish reading the full story, because that's basically what it is. The Native American community, as well as, you know, his Twitter followers and other people who are, you know, maybe culturally sensitive, find the headgear that he is wearing or the headdress to be basically insensitive, and he is dead wrong. My only issue is that, you know, everyone is coming after Pharrell, but what about L? And what about the photographer who actually took and thought of this idea to put on the cover? So
I think that Pharrell is an easy target because he's in the public eye. And we don't know the photographer. Like, we don't have a personal relationship with
Doug
the photographer.
English,
yeah, I understand that, but I personally don't know who that is. I don't care about the photographer.
If what Doug I'm English seeing, walked in here, we
I don't
know.
Care. But I have a relationship or a connection with world, yeah, person. But I'm not into the fashion world. So I do know for real. And I feel that it was insensitive. And when you are such a mega star like that, you have to be conscious of other people's feelings. Now, I know something was going on and it had something to do with Black people or the Black community, I would be pissed off. So I understand that. Like, they have every right to be. I can't tell someone not to stop feeling a certain way because I feel that it's okay for Pharrell to do that. I have to appreciate and respect someone else's feelings because they're feeling that way. So, yeah,
I feel like womp, 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 womp. Everybody always has so oversensitive about everything. Like, I think the cover is hot. I like the Indian feathers. I feel like he was paying homage. Why is everybody so sensitive? Like, Chris Brown has a song, These Hoes Ain't Loyal, and we worried about some feathers on Pharrell's head. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's art. Relax, people.
I understand that it's art, but everyone is not going to feel that way. So you have to be respectful of someone's feelings.
Get like, a new hobby.
I know
get
that.
Get some business. Get some business. Like, you're sitting around really mad at Pharrell. Like, they was laughing at him with the hat. Now look up. Everybody's wearing a hat.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody got to smoke it. He got it in green, brown. Everybody want to wear it.
Yeah. I think they are coming for him too much, though. They came for him when he didn't have a Black girl on the cover. Then people had stuff to say about the Marilyn Monroe.
She was biracial.
They said something when he did the Black girl as Marilyn.
Come for whoever they want to. It's everyone's opinion, and we are entitled to our opinions. So if I have something to say about something, I have a right to say it. You can listen to me, or you don't have to listen to me.
No, I agree with you.
The fact that I said it needs to be respected.
No, I agree with you. He was being insensitive. Yeah. I do agree with that. That as a superstar, you kind of have to.
And
be cognizant. You have to be cognizant that I can take a picture on Instagram with the headdress on, but you can't. But I'm just saying, as far as like in general, I feel like there's been a lot of negative attention, and he's been under scrutiny for everything he does.
Yeah,
be it wear
true.
An ugly ass hat or be it be on the cover. Everything he does is just like,
well, this
man,
is
the
price
live.
That you pay, unfortunately, when you walk into and come into true superstardom.
Yeah.
Let me say,
I mean,
though.
And he has been on the grind doing doing what he does, which is making hits, producing, writing songs, you know, just being this phenomenal artist and this creative genius. But now that since he has won this Grammy for this hot song and, you know, for all the works that he has done, now it's an issue because he has, you know, this award. Mm-hmm. And because he sat down
because he
Oprah.
Did Despicable Me. Yes. I'm happy.
Exactly.
It's a world
so now they
want to
take it away.
Well, the Native American community, they come for everybody, though. I was a Native American like 2 years ago for Halloween. I thought I was cute. Posted pictures on Instagram. I woke up to like hate tweets.
You
like,
are
my timeline.
Insensitive.
Are you serious?
Yes. And I mean, I'm nobody. And
girl,
they
you are
came
somebody
for me.
To somebody.
I mean, compared to Pharrell, like, who the hell? But I'm just saying, like, so they really don't play.
But I feel like there's always going to be a list. Like, the list has push notifications. Every time you turn around, there's a new thing added. Oh, you can't do this today because you did this. Yeah. And you're on this level and you can't do this. And you can't say this. And you can't. And the list, every time you, the list is, well, who's updating this damn list?
Yeah.
How we you are. Know? Like, every time you turn around, there's something else you're not supposed to be doing. You shouldn't have said because it's PC today and then tomorrow it's not PC. It's like, come on. Come on.
Well, I think that, you know, just because you're a megastar, you don't have to, you can do whatever you want to do, but I feel that it is your responsibility as well to be aware of, like, things that you do. I'm not saying that, okay, well, you're a megastar, I can't do this or I can't do that because people are going to come for me. I'm more saying that, you know, yeah, people are going to come for you. Be prepared. Yeah. You know?
Did you see that picture of Beyonce where she was sitting on the table and there was a painting of the Last Supper behind her?
Yes.
And they were like, oh my God, Beyonce is sitting in Jesus' seat. She's trying to say that she's God.
I don't like that.
Like, no, that I don't like. Yeah, I get it. She's sitting on the table.
Yeah. She's like, okay, so China. This is the perfect example because I agree with you. I don't see anything wrong with that. But then we have Michelle and Corrinne who are like, heck no, like that is not going to work. I don't see anything wrong with that.
There's a painting on the wall that she did not paint. She didn't paint it. It's there on the wall before she got there.
She said where she sat on purpose.
Oh, boom. My God. Maybe the camera person got the angle from that. Oh,
boom.
Lord.
Don't be brainwashed.
Let's bring it back
to Pharrell.
Yes.
Okay. Pharrell looked like he has some Native American in him, though, maybe.
All black people got Native American in
that Cherokee.
Actually, that is not true. You go to theroot.com, and there is a whole article on
how my grandma Native American. Honestly, I'm not even playing.
Nonetheless, so because Pharrell, it's under such scrutiny. He released a statement of apology through his publicist saying, I respect and honor every kind of race, background, and culture. I am genuinely sorry. Boom to the bone. So please just leave him alone and let him be happy. Mm-hmm. It's not like he woke up that morning and was like, "Ooh, today I'm gonna act like I am."
But why
smoking.
Is that? Why are they offended though with the feathers?
Oopsie.
But why are they offended?
They're offended by the feathers because they think that that's not an adequate representation of who they are,
it's
who
not.
They were
like,
as a culture.
Be,
like they don't walk around
honest,
with tomahawks like
it's
killing
not.
People.
It's not. And I get it. I understand. I truly do understand it. But at the end of the day, everyone's going to come at you no matter what. If you're doing good or if you're doing bad, you're going to get that positive and negative. So it's like, just do you. And if you feel the need to apologize, which Pharrell did, then do so.
Now, just quick question.
No, they didn't give him an option. That was not an option. It was like, look, you're going to apologize to us. They got the foot in the back of his neck. You're going to apologize to us, or we not going to like you no more.
They had that tomahawk at the back of his neck.
But if you think about it, it's the same thing. Remember Juliana Huff, was it this past Halloween when she, her costume. Yeah.
And that was, to me, the new black. That was I didn't
that
like
was
that
offensive,
at all. I felt like that was like offensive, but it's the same thing. Like, people are going to be sensitive to different situations, and I feel like the blackface was completely out of line, and it really digged deep in my heart. And some people were just like my white friends were like, Ashley, like, what? Like, what's the problem?
And that's like, how I feel. Like, she wants to be black.
Ooh, they get China,
a lot of white people get tans to be our skin color. It's Halloween. Everybody dresses up as hoes for Halloween. You know what I'm saying? This everyone's chance to be naked. This was her day. I can fully be black today.
But it's like, what if I dress up as a slave?
Okay, now that.
And that's the
because
same
that has
thing,
a negative
though.
Connotation.
But that's the same thing. Those Native Americans that they're dressing up with the headdress, and I'm guilty of it. I said it's the same
it's
thing.
It's the historical context that it's that goes with
the same time they was in those head wraps. That's when we was at. That's
now
when
that
we were in train.
It's the same
parallel.
Thing.
Okay. Well, honey.
This is too deep. Let's go to topic three.
On
we got to keep this light
and
happy.
And the last topic. Keisha Cole's family is back. In case you missed them, I know I did.
Well, I didn't.
Keisha Cole has stated numerous times that she'd rather not have her family on television, but her mom, Frankie, and sister, Neffy, are going against her wishes once again and attempting to star in yet another reality show.
No shade, but is Frankie still a crackhead? Sorry.
That was all the way shady.
I'm just saying.
This time around, they've railed in six other siblings who we have never met before for an intense reality show called Family therapy. Oh, yes. You want to hear the premise? On the new show, everyone will live together while publicly discussing their family secrets. Let's see. With a therapist, such as Frankie's past as a prostitute, one of the siblings being born with cocaine in his system, and growing up dealing with drug-addicted fathers, all of them.
Keisha, different fathers.
Of course, yes, they all have different daddies. Keisha Cole, of course, will not be a part of this. And, you know, this is very troubling. I mean, I'm going to watch because I definitely enjoy Neffy and Frankie. I love the show. And I want to see, you know, what's up with these new siblings. But it's such a shame because in 2010, if you guys remember when Neffy and Frankie had their own reality show.
Yeah.
You know, Keisha went on a little soapbox like, yo, I'm not fooling with y'all no more. You need to stop. You guys are embarrassing me. This looks ridiculous. All of our dirty laundry does not need to be out there to the magnitude in which it is. And so even till this day, like she was on the Breakfast Club doing an interview in March. And she was like, yo, I love them, but from a distance, from afar. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, what are you guys' thoughts on this? Do you think that this is something that they should do? Should they try to make amends with Keisha behind closed doors without the camera? Or are you just excited like me and you want to watch this?
I'm not excited at all.
Holla!
I feel like...
Oh, we have a clip of it, too.
I feel like family are going to fight and argue anyway. So the show probably just egged it on even more. But at the same time, if someone's offering them some money to do a show or whatever, and she's not gonna pay their bills.
Take it.
Hey,
you know they're broke.
You gonna pay me what they're paying me, or you're not? Okay, so if you're not paying me, then I'm gonna go ahead and take this job over here.
That's what I'm saying. Neffy has lots of kids. She needs to check. Frankie is like in and out of rehab. And remember, she was on Celebrity Rehab. And then she was on like some other show. Yeah.
But what did they do before?
With Dr. Drew.
What did they do before they got the show and everything? Okay.
Neffy was in the Bay like... You know, she was having that messy divorce or separation I'm with my husband, I'm not with my husband, and had lots of kids. And then on the second season of Keisha Cole, that's when Elite, their other sister, Elite. Frankie's daughter. Yeah, Frankie has a lot of kids, remember?
I think that Keisha Cole is becoming more mainstream. I think she's stepping out of this, like,
black. I think you're taking it too far there.
No, I mean, she has a shoe line with, like, Steve Madden and stuff. You know, she's trying to step outside of the, like, black entertainment television. No?
Niche,
and I mean, become more mainstream a little bit. And I think that them having this ratchet show could potentially hurt other business endeavors she might be trying to expand on, which is essentially hurting her coins, which is hurting their coins. Whoa. So they might want to think about that.
No, I think that she does that to herself.
Keisha Cole hurts her own coins.
Yes.
Daniel's,
you know, sometimes she, not she, but sometimes
Daniel
people think that they're like, Oprah, when they're really like, ... What does everybody else think?
I say, Frankie and Neffy, get your money. Make your money.
I'm going to be watching. And right now, the show has yet to be picked up. And I don't know why. It looks like a great show fit for VH1, BET, TV1, Centric.
Maybe BET on a late night.
Okay, but she has all the attitude.
I just feel like, no, because I just don't think that this is going to be a really good show. I think it's just going to be a train wreck, just like that Whitney Houston show was. Like, nobody really, ain't nobody trying to see Bobby Christina drunk again. Nobody wants to see Frankie and Neffy on crack again. We're over it. So
Neffy was
like,
never on crack.
Whatever. I don't
only
care.
Only Frankie.
See, the thing is, I don't know the details because I didn't watch the show because I didn't care.
Well, I did, and I'm a fan, and I would love to see you guys work through your family issues and have this one-on-one therapy.
And come on Reality
and
Check.
And come on Reality Check. Holla. All right, let's get into the interview with China. Oh, so, did you have anything to say about it, China?
I'm going to interview me?
Yes. Oh my gosh.
So you're on LA Hair, and I did read that, you know, you were really inspired by your mother. Your mother, is she still a beautician?
Negative.
Okay, so you were inspired by your mother. She was a beautician. You were?
No.
Oh.
My mother is a beautician.
Tried it, honey. Sorry, let's backtrack. So what inspired you to be?
The mannequin heads.
The mannequin heads. Yeah.
So I thought, I was reading your bio and it said that you went to a school, you know, when you were younger. And who used to take you?
My mom used to take me to be.
Okay, so that's where I got the inspiration from. Okay, so your mother used to take you to the beauty schools. And so you got inspired by your mother taking you to the place by mannequin heads. And
totally, yeah.
Just throw my mom in there somewhere.
Yeah, just throw it in there.
Just clear it up for us.
Well, basically, yeah. So when I was little, it started out as me like rebelling, wanting to do hair. Like my sister had this long, like pretty, like flowy, thick, luxurious hair. And I always wanted to play in it. My mom would never let me. So I got these little doll heads. And then I was at, it was Pick and Save when I was younger. Pick and Save when I was younger. And I would go there and buy these little $2-3 curling irons and I'd be curling the doll's head. It wouldn't curl or it would burn up or melt or whatever. Yeah. So then my mom took me to the beauty college to get my hair done one day. And I saw these life-size heads. I was in love. I was like, oh my God, you can curl them and they don't burn up and I can cut them and they're a real head. And so I begged one of the girls at the school to let me take her doll home. So, you know, I was racing home every day, curling this doll head all excited. And then I was like, all right, I want to do hair. But I don't want to just do hair. I don't want to be a hairstylist that sits in a salon doing 25 heads a day. That was never like my dream. Mm-hmm. I always said I want to work with people with money.
Come on,
man. And I want to work with famous people if I can't be famous myself. And then what do you know?
Boom,
there's
boom.
LA hair.
So what kind of hairstyles did you used to do on the mannequin heads?
Finger waves.
Yeah, it was. it wasn't really a style. It was just more like just curling it. Just yeah.
Did you ever did you ever do like those waterfalls?
I did. I did. Back in the banana day. Peels. Well, I sure did. I did.
So how did you go about meeting Kim Kimball?
How I met Kim Kimball. Well, in any industry that you're in, I think everyone should know the top dogs.
Right.
So I always knew that Kim Kimball was like one of the top dogs in the hair business. And when I heard that she moved and she opened a new salon, it was on Holloway and La Cienega. I said, you know, I'm going to go there and I'm going to apply to work. So I went there, applied to work. She had heard of me and was, you know. Yeah, I was like,
what? From Elgin?
From Elgin, Charles. I worked at Angel's in Beverly. Come I worked on, at a lot Angel's. Of salons around Beverly Hills. Yeah, so... Yeah, so then I went there, and then I started working with her. And then, you know, started working in the salon. The next thing you know, I was flying here. I'm flying there. I'm in Chicago one day. I'm in Vegas one day. I'm here. I'm doing all her clients here.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So my resume grew just from doing her clients.
And then how did you become a part of the show? Because I know you came towards the middle of season one.
Yeah, because when she closed her salon down for remodeling, and then I didn't go back to work there. I was already at another salon for a while, so I just stayed there. And then so I guess once they did the pilot, and once the show got picked up, then she submitted like a bunch of names of people that she worked with, and then they called me.
Oh.
So then I was gonna go like audition and all that.
What was the auditioning process like?
A bunch of shit talking. A bunch of just sit you in front of a camera, ask you a whole bunch of questions, and I probably was making all the weird faces. And, you know, like her. Yeah, they're telling me about stuff I didn't even know was happening. Like, so Angela and Kim don't like each other?
What?
Tell me more.
So did you feel like you kind of had to, like, juice up everything to actually get on the show, or were you just being yourself?
I was being myself. I'm great at that, so I stick with that. So much easier to be me than someone else.
Yeah.
Not right.
I mean, were you okay? So Beverly Hills Fabulous, which was Elgin Charles's show.
Mm-hmm.
How was that in the timeline of when LA Hair started? Because you had already left Elgin Charles by that point. So were you looking back, kind of like, oh well, maybe I should?
Not at all, because I worked at Elgin Charles Salon in '99, 2000.
Okay.
Yes. That long ago.
It didn't say it in the bio. You thought it was recent. Thank you.
No, but then a few people were saying oh, she was on Beverly Hills Fabulous, too. It's like, that's why I said people be talking, and they don't know.
I
know Beyonce was just posing with the picture
in
the background.
Oh, here she go. Back to Beyonce. Get your mark, China.
So do you feel the need to, like, kind of set people straight when they have, like, misconstrued information about you, or do you kind of just, like, let it go?
It depends on what it is.
Got that right.
Because normally I will argue you down about everything that's wrong, and then it's just like, nah, you're not going to get it anyway, so.
So do you set them straight, like, social media, or do you, like, go directly to them?
It depends on what it is and who's saying what. Like, for one of my pet peeves that people, even people that I know, do, and it may be small to you, but it's big to me, but you spell my name with a Y,
It drives me bonkers.
Please make sure that her name is not spelled with a Y.
The name is spelled correctly.
Because when you Google China, the country,
it's with
China.
An I.
All this new fancy new age with a Y. It's like, come on, people want to ask me, is that your real name? Yes, that is my birth name, China. Mm. My bills say China. So that drives me crazy. So China. In that situation, I might put out a general little, hey, yeah, you spelled my name wrong. Boop, don't do it again.
Oh.
But I mean, I'll tell somebody how I feel. I'm not a sneak behind your back type
China
of person.
Is ready at all times.
How do you deal okay. with like the negative like comments?
The first,
how do you deal with the stress?
Well, the first season, it was like, oh, I'm fighting everybody. I'm arguing with everybody. Everybody's saying something crazy. Oh, I'm saying something back, blah, blah, blah. And then I would say something back on Twitter, and then the people would be like, Why are you responding back? You making me relevant by responding. Right. And then I would get even more mad. Right.
And then you
want to
say something else.
And then I'm like, wait, and before I know it, I'm a whole dialogue back and forth. And their friend's like, oh my gosh, she's arguing with you. Like, it's like someone else, like I noticed even on Instagram comments, someone told me, I was asking them, like, why do they make these mean comments on people's pages? Mm-hmm. And then someone said the reason why they do that is because everyone else starts attacking the person who made the mean comment. And then it's not even about the picture anymore. It's about sticking up for this person who's saying something. Because I was like, people have brain damage.
Yes.
Who thinks of that?
Yeah. Well, in terms of the show, what are your relationships like with the other stylists?
That face explains it all.
If Les could kill.
I see him when I see him, really.
You're like, I love Kim. Holla. No, keep me employed.
So. I'm cool with Kim. I'm cool with Lisa. I'm cool with Terry. I'm cool with Dante, but Terry and Dante, I don't really talk to them on the phone like a lot.
Right.
Anthony, I don't talk to him on the phone unless he's apologizing for some dumb shit he said.
He's always apologizing.
Yeah. And then, I mean, Leah, I'm cool with her. Jazz, I'm cool with her. But who else is there?
That's it.
Exactly.
That's all we're asking about.
Exactly.
She is ready. Exactly. Y'all just was asking about this season. The stylist this season in the shop, okay? In the shop, okay? Well, what are the pros and cons of actually being an actual working stylist on a reality TV show?
The pros and cons.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I guess the pros would be that reality TV is pretty much like a spotlight. If you feel like you're someone who, you know, you're talented and maybe you just haven't got the platform to present your talent, reality TV is a place to do that. Mm-hmm. But the cons would be now that I'm a celebrity hairstylist and I might do so-and-so's hair, after I finish doing their hair, I got to go get dressed so I can stand on the red carpet next to them taking pictures.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of weird. And then it's kind of like maybe I'm have 2-3 jobs and then maybe I miss being the talent myself because I'm working, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, do I go to the BET Awards and sit down in the chair or do I
work and do the hair?
Yeah. And be behind the scenes.
Well, yeah, you gotta eat.
Huh? I mean, yeah. Or do I go host a party and stand around and smile or go do manual labor?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how do you do what determines the decision at the end of the day?
Whichever way the wind blows. Today, all right. Today, I'm going to be talent. Woo!
Yeah. So I know that, you know, with doing celebrity hairstyles, it comes with a big price tag. Do you ever do like, okay, so say, for example, if we came to the salon and we wanted to get our hair done, do we have that celebrity price or would you give, like, what is our, do we get like a regular price or is it just like?
There isn't a celebrity price.
Oh, okay.
There's
so,
a cross-the-board price.
Oh, yeah. Really?
Yeah, there's a cross-the-board price. It's either you can afford to get your hair done there or you can't.
So say if someone wants to come in and get like a full sew-in, what's your price?
My price or the salon's
price? Your price. Like at your price at the salon, if I was to come and say I want a full sew-in, how much is it?
It could be from anywhere for a partial to a full weave. Could be anywhere from $300 to $800.
Jeez,
that's not including the hair.
Okay, three.
Yeah, you gotta bring your
own. If you bring
hair,
your own hair,
you don't really. I don't, and I'm like, you need to get the hair where I'm telling you to get it from. Because if you're getting some hair, if you're getting some hair from some other place, I'm like, it's not gonna benefit the both of us because I know what this could look like.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, help me, help you.
So it's $300 without the hair.
That's probably a partial, yeah.
Ashley want her hair done, FYI.
No, I'm just saying because
like, what is it?
Because I know that there's a place downtown that I go to, and like they all have different prices. And so, like for example, if she does a celebrity client, it's a different price than what she would give me.
Yeah, no, I don't have that. I have prices across the board, but
I would say how it ends up being different for a celebrity. Like when they call to book you for a job, they're gonna call the agency who's right. gonna book you for either a half a day or a whole day. Mm-hmm. So your day rate may end up being more than what the average person would pay, but they're paying you to have you for the whole day for whatever they need you for.
That makes right. sense.
Yeah. Now I still have more questions about the show. So this season we see that you got your sister a job.
Yes.
Yay.
Yes.
So how was you guys' relationship like when you're actually filming and like...
Me and my sister?
Yeah. Like how, like how was it? Because I only seen her what? On this past episode? And then the one
Well, you
prior.
Haven't really been seeing much of any of us on the show, really. Yeah. It's not, it's, yeah, I don't know what's going on with you. Because even I've been watching.
What show you watching, Corrine?
Yeah. Okay, honey. Her sister, she got her sister a job yeah, on the show. Did. So I'm asking how the relationship is, what is it like? I know if I was working with my sister, we wouldn't be breathing. I love you.
Well, my sister heard, and because I would call and vent to her, the previous seasons of all the stuff that was right. going on. So she already came in with the side eye like, mm-hmm. Because uh-huh. I basically filled her in telling her, oh my God, this happened today. And, you know, crying her, telling her. So it was like side eye. But when we got off work, it was like we were too tired to do anything anyway because yeah. we film all day long. Oh, so okay. we pretty much go home, get in the bed, and go to sleep and wake up again tomorrow, the next day.
So was this a part of the plot? Like, did the producer scheme this? Or was this like a genuine, I want to bring my sister on to the cast? Like to work with me, or was it the producer saying, we need some more drama, let's spice this up, let's bring her we need some,
well, they always want more drama, whether it's with my sister right. or not, yeah. But I don't know, I think I just kind of said, hey, you know, I wanted to go to at least go to lunch or something with my sister. Can I just have someone I can go and sit and right, talk uh-huh. shit with at lunch? Because right. there is no one. I don't have any like allies. I'll say, is there anyone?
Your own.
Yeah. So then they bring her on and then we don't get to go anywhere. We didn't go anywhere. We was in the salon all day. I didn't never get to go sit and talk to her about whatever.
She's sitting
so
there.
I know, I know like on other reality shows, they are allowed to have like a plus one for certain seasons. Are you guys allowed that? Like a plus one, like for example, for Basketball Wives LA, they're allowed to bring like one other person of interest onto the show for that season.
Oh, well,
so was your sister?
Oh, okay. Sister.
Different network.
Sorry.
Right. Much bigger paycheck.
Right.
I'm sure
different network.
Yes.
Okay.
And that was a read. And that Shade was. And
read.
All that.
We all need to band y'all heard together it. And get a raise. Like the woman of Roja. Real Housewives of Atlanta. What's yeah. up? Okay, so last season, we saw that you had a slight incident with Vivica Fox.
Oh, yeah, it's just slight.
So,
major.
You know, wetterization of the wigs mm-hmm. or what have you. Mm-hmm. What was the decision behind that? And current present day, do you regret it?
I love your facial expression.
Wait, regret what?
Wetting the wigs.
I do not. No? I would do it again. Oh. I would do it again. I would do it better this time.
Now, what did we not see that got you so like worked up?
A lot. Let's just say a whole lot. Basically, like, her coming on the show, I wanted to make it worth her while as well. I know she had a wig on.
You said that.
Yeah, she had a wig on. And I was like, hey, you know, let's do this shoot. Let's bring some of your wigs. And so she gave me some of her wigs. The wigs that she gave me were synthetic. They weren't real. Okay, I'm like, you have your own wig line. Surely you should know the difference between synthetic and whatever. She gave it to me. Everything I tried to do backfired. I tried to not involve her, handle it myself. There was a $400 difference between the wigs. I wasn't doing that. I had my own wigs that I would use for shoots, but I wanted to use your wigs. So when I let her know, mm-hmm. hey, this blah, 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 we go to the store. She's like, I want the lighter one. I get the lighter one. No, I want it darker, blah, blah, blah. It just was a mess. Like, I went to my car, I'm looking for something. I literally was gone 3 minutes. She sends someone out to the car looking for me, blah, blah, blah. Then you do all that. I say to you, I say, hey, listen, I'm trying to be respectful of the woman because I do respect my elders. I'm trying to be respectful of her.
Shame.
I didn't go off on her. I didn't cuss at her, nothing. I'm working, but I'm still a person and you're not going to be talking to me crazy. So we're sitting there. I tell her, I said, listen, I'm like, hey, it was a point where I said, hey, can we have real talk? Where I was getting ready to tell her about whatever happened. Oh, real talk was when, nah, nah, nah. I'm like, here we go. So I'm sitting there.
I'm sitting there. I'm off in my happy place. You sit Precious. You know how Precious, whenever yes. something crazy was happening, she went somewhere else. That's where I was. I was over here. I'm listening. And I'm thinking, like, we're wasting time. She's sitting up here just going off about whatever. We're wasting time. So that's when I went to go finish curling the wig. Yes. And that pissed her off. And you want to go hide in the bathroom and not come out and talk to me and use your words? Like, even preschoolers can do that. Yeah. Like, come on. Let's talk about it. Let's get to the bottom of it so we can do this, okay? But no. What do you want?
I'm not coming in the bathroom until she leaves, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, when my other hairstylist come, he just going to come. He going to set up right there. And she's almost done with that wig, so we'll be ready to go in 5 minutes. No, the hell you won't.
Oh.
Oh, no, you won't. No, he's not going to, because I literally had about 3 more curls left. He's not about to come in here, take these pins out, fix the front, and then you get some flow hair. No. So it was either me sit there and flat iron it and whatever. So I wet the wig. Now, listen. Be clear. If I wanted to be shady or dirty or whatever, I could have set that wig on fire.
Ooh.
I could have put gum in it.
Oh.
I could have put some gum in it. I could have cut it.
Oh.
But I wasn't trying to be malicious. I'm just like, let me rinse it out. So when he come, he got a fresh canvas. Here's your fresh canvas. I was trying to dry it off. They were like, just go. She wants you to leave. So I left. Bye. I was supposed to do my photo shoot. It didn't happen that day.
You went the next day, didn't it?
Not the next day, but it happened. So it was like, it didn't stop nothing. Everybody know you crazy. Everybody know you crazy, okay?
Have you seen her since then?
I have not.
Okay.
Nope. Ooh. I mean, but what? I mean, what?
And I was just going to ask, like, if there was any, like, dirty looks or anything.
For what?
She had a nice wig on.
Man.
Okay, next.
We tried to work together. It didn't work out. Moving on. If I did see her out, really, should not have time to be thinking about rolling her eyes at me. You know what I'm saying?
So you did mention that everyone knows that she's crazy. Did you have any like feelings going into it? Like, okay, let me like brace myself for this girl.
Several people have told me, other celebrities, other A-list celebrities have told me about her. They've said, hey, blah, 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 whatever, whatever. And I'm just like, I'll see how it is myself. Like, mm-hmm. I hung out with her. She hosted my cousin's birthday party. It was cool. We had no problems. And then this day, it was some other thing going on. Oh, and then, you're an hour late. Now, if you watch it again, she was sitting there with no makeup on. Her makeup wasn't even done. Uh-huh. She was not waiting on me.
Mm-hmm.
She hadn't had a fitting. No one was waiting on me. But it's my shoot. I set it up. I should have just been there early to just...
For you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just so you feel better. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, I was not wrong.
Any other celebrities that you've worked with that were kind of nightmares that you want to?
I wouldn't say they were nightmares. I might have had some problems getting my money when it was time to pay.
That means they broke.
Or they might have just been having a meltdown that day and then something happened. But no.
So they don't pay up front. They pay like after the job is done.
Else. Like after the job is done, or if they be bouncing checks, it'll be invoiced.
Sorry, complain.
Of course. Yeah.
So on the show, do you feel that you are 100%? Portrayed authentically as China.
What I feel is that it is a 45-minute show.
Ooh.
That is split camera time with 9 or 10 people.
Sure.
That's filmed 4 or 5 days, 8 to 10 hours a day.
Damn.
So when you add all that in, and in that time you just happen to piss me off for a day, and 10 minutes of me going off is the whole show.
Yep. Yeah.
I mean, it's real. It really happened, but that's not only me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Do you get upset when you look back on these shows and you see like yourself in a negative light? Do you get mad because you know what happened just before that, and you know what it was to piss you off, and that's all that they're gonna show, but they didn't show like me being happy and like, you know, having a good time the entire day?
I used to, the first season I did, because I couldn't understand, like, I really thought I was gonna be the comedian, come on, laugh and joke and blah 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 whatever, but they saw something else. Oh, we push her button, she's gonna go crazy, blah 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 whatever. They saw that. So okay, what was the question? I had like 5 things going here.
Girl, give us all 5 of them.
I'm like,
let it flow, girl. She's like, wait,
no, really. Yeah, I'm like, I
do you get frustrated when you see that they left out parts that you knew would happen?
So I used to, but I don't anymore, just because the goal is to get ratings. So if you feel like whatever I did was going to get ratings, that's cool. Because a lot of people, like I told you,
Yeah. Crazy people on Twitter that say the crazy stuff that they say, really, you never know. And it'll be a picture of a cat there and or an arm or something. They don't even show their face, but they're talking the craziest. You never know.
That is people too know how to find much.
You. I might check in somewhere. And they, anyway.
Have you ever had an encounter like that where it was like this crazy person who was pissed off at you and they found you and went off on you?
She wasn't pissed. But what she said was kind of weird. Oh. It was kind of like she was kind of like, yeah, like she kind of walked up to me and my sister. She kind of walked up to me, looked me up and down. She was like, oh, okay. Like, are you cute or whatever? But you crazy, but you cute. I was like, okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Later.
That is weird.
Yeah, so, I mean, people will be across the room, and they look like they want to say something, but they don't, because they think I'm going to turn around and snap on them, like, on TV or whatever, but, I mean, that's just, yeah. But, no, I used to the first season, and then now I don't, because, like, the same people that are like, oh, my God, what the season's on, we hate you, you ugly, you fat, you bald-headed, you blah, blah, blah. It's like when they see you out, they forget that they hate you.
Yeah.
They forget like, that they don't like your, yeah, oh they'll God. Be like, oh, yeah. They'll be like, hey, girl. Yeah. Or they'll be like, you look so familiar. Where do I know you from? And I'll be like, oh, girl, I'll be around. and after they get way down the road, I'm like, that's China.
But so, would you actually know, though, if you saw someone that was, like, hating on you on social media, you would actually, like,
if
remember,
they had a
like,
picture,
that was that
if,
girl?
If they had a picture up and they sent me enough messages and it was crazy enough, I would remember the face.
But you wouldn't say anything in person. Like,
I'm not going to walk up to them.
No, if they walked up to you, like, trying to be friendly, like, oh, my God, let's take a picture. Would you be like, hell no?
Oh, no, I wouldn't say hell no, but I would surely tell, hey, your name is Fly Guy on Twitter, right? And you hit me the other day saying something about, okay, so did you really mean? Like, I would be just all reading okay, their, read flip it on them. Okay. So then at that point, it's like, either they're going
to
be
they don't
like,
want the
oh.
picture no more.
Yeah, no, they might be like, oh, okay, blah, blah, whatever. But then they might be like, yeah, she is crazy. Crazy. She bust me right out. But no, that hasn't happened.
Okay.
It hasn't happened.
So it's my last question about LA hair, and then we can move on to you. What did you think about the fight between First Lisa and Anthony? And then why y'all fighting this season?
Well, I had a fight first.
I saw that in the trailer.
Yeah, I had the first
but
fight.
But it was a long time coming
it
for
was.
Her.
Who, for Lisa? Oh, for me and Anthony?
No, Ant.
Yeah, I've been telling Anthony for the longest. Anthony is from Torrance. And I've been
T-Town.
Telling him. I was like, listen, I literally told him, it's real out here in these streets. And you need to... You can't just say whatever you want to say. Like, him and Naja think because there's cameras in their face, they can say whatever, and they're protected, and they get a pass.
So you think people get a little bit more ballsy in front of the camera?
Well, yeah. Anthony was getting crazy with
crazy.
Lisa.
Crazy. And don't even know. And he don't even know. Mine was an innocent little hairspray fight.
Oh.
But it ended in my knees are still bruised up from it. But yeah, I sprayed him in the face.
Somebody's
with some hairspray.
Blind.
That's
but
what it was. Because I'm ignorant. I'm not gonna stop. It's not gonna end with just a fight. It's gonna be a fight and a kick, and you gonna be sitting on Sunset 3 weeks later, sipping a mimosa and get conked upside the head. That's how I am. It's not gonna die this
Spoiler
day.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah, it's not gonna die today. It's gonna keep going. Right when you think I ain't coming, I'm a Terminator. I'm gonna be dragging one leg and one arm on a mission.
Is there anything you've done on the show that you regret or kind of like cringe when you think about?
She's like, hell no. No, no, look at her face.
You know, the first season, my reaction when Anthony called me a bitch, and there was a little old lady sitting under the dryer, and she was like, you know, God said that, blah, 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 whatever, whatever. I mean,
don't nobody want to hear all that.
I probably would say it again just the way I said it, but it was just kind of like, are you hearing what's going on? You over here trying to throw Bible scriptures in this. This man just called me a bitch to my face, and you trying to put out the fire with a Bible verse?
No, girl, she's trying
not
to get
the right
her
time.
Airtime. Get your life.
Man.
She was like, I'm about to be the salon spiritual leader.
And we have
Hallelujah.
Those. And we have those, too, that come in trying to get airtime. Want to be a cowboy, want to come in and do something crazy, like, just to try to get some attention.
So do you have people, coming off the street, like, daily, like, all the time when you guys are recording?
No, they don't let them come off the street.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they have to.
So, do they just like choose them? So the producers are standing outside, and it's kind of like you have to like go through them to get inside.
No, there's no line outside. They just, I think, like casting directors. They get people.
LACasting.com. Holla.
Okay,
so because I got sent something to come and get my hair done.
Yeah, they're just looking for my
Okay, so it's not necessarily like
regular people.
Clients that y'all have on the
well,
books.
Well, some regular clients, but a lot of regular clients don't want to come
to
on.
Be on air.
Yeah, yeah. That's true. Yeah, that I can sense. See that.
She's
yeah.
one of my regular clients and my friends. And
hey,
she
girl.
She
hey,
doesn't girl. She doesn't want to come on yeah. air. Like, I said, look, just sit there. Just don't she's say like, nothing no, in your microphone.
Because you know when you get your hair done, you have to go through that stage at the beginning. Mm-hmm. When you don't look that cute when you're
yeah.
in the chair
oh, yeah,
but
weather.
So no, I wouldn't want to or no you had no makeup on I your weave not in you don't want to be seen on camera like that I wouldn't well, personally yeah,
no they're just usually getting it styled not too many women was getting weaves.
Oh, well, see. Yeah. But you never said what you thought about the fight between Lisa and Anthony. And then,
oh, the fight.
And then the other fight.
Oh, no, I was waiting for that. I was like, finally, finally, Anthony, you got what I've been trying to tell you was coming. Like
she was about to get him real good. She choked him out a little
bit. Y'all
saw the
watered down version. Like, she really had him by the throat in the mirror. Not just a little tap. She had him in the mirror. And I was sitting over there like, yeah, yeah. But it happened so quick, so fast, it was kind of like. Yeah, but he might have some scared straight, but maybe not. Because Akon came and had
yeah,
a little
I saw
talk.
That.
He still didn't get it.
But he was like, Akon loves me. Just
he still didn't get it. He did not get it. He don't get it. He's a Scorpio, too.
Did he ever buy her clippers?
He did.
Oh, well,
maybe
praise
some
God.
Weeks later.
Now, what about the other fight with Naja and the other one?
Well,
who won, you know, in your opinion?
I don't know about winning. I'm not going to say about winning.
Oh.
But I'm just saying, let's just say that Naja hasn't been able to do nails since. Okay? Let's just say that.
God damn, God damn. Okay. Yeah. Okay, well, all right. So let's that's just all say I got that. About LA here.
Mm-hmm. So let's move on to your...
let's move on to China.
To Showtie. Tell us a little bit more about Showtie. I know a lot of your fans really want to know exactly, you know, what it is, what inspired you to do this.
Well, Showtie is actually my friend. His name is Aaron Richardson. Mm-hmm. He has these ties. And they're unique ties. They call them show ties. It's like show ties, like bow tie, but show tie. So it's a little tie. And they're different colors and stripes or whatever. And he's been wearing them. Like, I've known him since college. And I was always like, why don't you do something with him? So it's still in development. It's his company.
Okay.
I'm just like the creative director and want to, you know, help it get out there.
That's nice.
Yeah.
So he's still working. You should bring him on your show.
On my
LA
show?
Hair. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know how people come into the beauty supplies, not the beauty, but the beauty shop? I got CDs, I got ribs, I got chicken grease.
We selling fish plates
right
later today.
Okay, they would edit them right out.
So do you see yourself owning your own salon one day?
I did want to own my own salon, but the older I get, the more I'm like, if I did, it'd probably be like a small boutique salon, like four chairs or something. Like, and then I would have one, I would have an assistant, my sister would work there, and it'd probably be room for a barber.
That sounds like a good setup.
Yeah, that's pretty much what,
no stress,
yeah.
No mess.
Yeah, because I've worked at really big salons with over 20 stylists and then smaller salons. And then you have 20-something chairs, 24 chairs, and then you don't have 12 of them filled.
Yeah.
That rent.
Money, money,
still
money.
Come around every month. Water, electricity, all that. Like, and a lot of salon owners, they wish they wouldn't have opened a salon.
Really?
Uh-huh.
That sucks.
Yeah, why?
Because they make more money in products, not like Boot Friend. Boot Friend is set every week. They make money if they have commission. If you have a commission, you're feeding them a lot of clients, then the scale is up. But if you're just paying Boot Friend, you're not really making a killing.
So are you thinking about maybe working on like a hair care line?
I am overfloweth with ideas. I have so many ideas that I don't know which one to do first. So, like, right now, I'm currently looking for a competent manager with connections and is in good standing with people.
Yeah.
Has
come,
a good reputation.
Come on, good standing.
Reputation right. In the industry.
Come on, reps.
But I feel like I have so many ideas and so many different things I want to do and so many ways to go. If I have the right person that can help me facilitate all these ideas, then, yeah, I could be pew. You know?
So, you want to do it all. Hair, nails.
Yeah,
makeup.
I wouldn't say nails, but makeup. No. Definitely makeup.
Fashion.
Definitely, yeah, fashion, makeup.
So what's the one thing that stands out to you? Like, you have all of these different ideas. What's the one that you would want to pursue first?
Probably producing TV.
Really? Oh. That was left field?
I have ideas for shows. I have ideas for shows. I used to write when I was younger. My dad was recently in a motorcycle accident.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, he was in
a motorcycle. Is he okay?
He's okay now. He's in rehab, but he was in a motorcycle accident probably like a month ago. And it was really like traumatizing for me and my sister. Like, he was in a medically induced coma for like a week and a half.
And he is slowly becoming like, why was I telling you that? What did you ask me?
See, because I have so many, look, I have so many things, because I was thinking to myself too, like, she's a nurse, and she was at the hospital helping me with everything with my dad. So I'm thinking of that and this and that.
You're talking about producing shows.
Oh, right, right. Okay, bam. Okay, so this situation with my dad, basically him being in a medically induced coma, his girlfriend drama, like relatives coming up there, me fighting doctors and all that, I want to write a movie about it.
Oh, okay.
It was crazy. Like, no one will believe all the stuff. You think, oh, I'm just going to be here for my dad. I'm like, I'm standing in the hospital. I'm looking crazy. I'm down at the cafeteria. The cafeteria lady asked me if I was a client. I had on pajamas and a hood. Looking crazy. Hospital socks. Just ups and downs. People coming in there. The stuff that they were saying. Like, he's a fireman. They're coming in there trying to get him to retire. It's bonkers.
Dang. So if you were to put a movie. If you were to produce this as a show, what network would you see this show
on? Well, not a show, more like a movie. I would do a movie or a book.
So if you, but I
is
know
it gonna
that
be straight to Lifetime, or you have it envisioned for the big screen?
You said Lifetime.
Yeah.
It's watered down. I'm thinking more like F. Gary Gray. Set it off. Yeah. Yeah, this will be a little thug story.
So I know, I'm really interested to know more about television production, because you did say that you want to produce television shows. Mm-hmm. So if you were to produce television shows, what network would you see them on? I just kind of want to get a gauge of how, like, good this going to be. Because, you know, if you do BET, you know, you're going to get your little ratchet, but it's going to be good.
Yeah, I didn't think that.
VH1, Classy Ratchet, and then... You got like, it's Classy Ratchet.
VH1, really basketball-wise.
Upscale. They cute, though.
Love and hip hop. Classy Ratchet.
Okay.
Get your life.
I would say WeTV or OWN.
Bravo.
WeTV, OWN, or I'm trying to think of another one that like, might be a cool one.
Oxygen.
Maybe Oxygen.
Oxygen's gone.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'm thinking it's Down Network.
Yeah, maybe even Revolt.
Revolt? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, so I have ideas for shows that are different, like out of the box. I think Revolt, actually.
Yeah, it's edgy, it's young, urban.
Do you want to act as well?
I would do it. I definitely would.
Given the opportunity?
Like, I would love to be on Real Husbands of Hollywood.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, me too.
Just doing some crazy, funny improv.
So what's your personality most like for those of us who don't personally know you?
I'm goofy. I can be a bitch at times. I do have attitude.
No. No.
I am a little weird. I'm loud. I don't know. I talk shit. I'm funny. I'm crazy. I like to dance. When I go to clubs, I dance.
Really? Mm-hmm. So you're like on the dance floor kicking it, not
twerking.
Like,
oh, twerk. Yeah. I'm not standing on the wall unless the DJ's whack. Yeah, if the DJ's whack, then I've even went up to the DJ booth, listen.
Oh.
So can we play some music where we can dance? Because.
Oh. So is China currently in a relationship?
China is not.
She's single and ready to mingle.
I just have a lot of crushes.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, no. Like, okay, one. Yeah. We need one. Give us that.
See, I don't really want to.
Just give us, okay, come on. Give us some initials.
It might be a love connection, girl. Go for it.
Okay.
I did have one, but then he got in a relationship.
What, is Young. He a celebrity?
It was Serge Ibaka. And then he got with Carrie Hilson.
Hilson.
So then it was like, you know, I don't like to share, man. I like my own man. So the fantasy little cloud just went away.
Let's get another one since he's taken.
Okay, so my other one would say would be Michael Johnson. He just got traded to the really Buccaneers.
Cute. Yes, yeah. He did. Mm-hmm. I don't know who that is.
All right.
He's cute.
She like him chocolate.
So do you feel yourself concentrating so much on your career that you kind of don't have time for a relationship? Is that why you're single? Or
absolutely
is it
not.
Just because...
I live in California. That's what it is.
So do you have plans to move to the East Coast?
You know,
down south?
South. I'm
stuck
on
Southern Boys now.
I want to stop
I'm
you
stuck
because
on Southern Boys now.
I want to get
oh
to
God.
The... No.
Oh God.
You were like, it's because I'm in California. I agree with you. Where are the men's? I mean...
They being not loyal.
Right.
No, loyal. I feel like some... sometimes these I feel like I'm the only one that feels Californians that way, and other people are like, it's a whole bunch of Jews. No, they're not. There's no Jews in LA.
There are, but it's they're not bad bitches taking you out on dates.
Girl, and then not even buying when you a drink at the bowl.
No, of course not. I mean, when you have when you got Susie, you can hang out with Susie on Monday, Floozy on Tuesday, and
Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Wednesday,
every day of the week. Why would you just be with one? Like, I think in southern states, they have where they get snowed in, they rain. No, no,
she's trying to drop on that now, bitch. You ain't going nowhere.
They do. They have that. They get
snowed in. It's a snow day. You invite him over on a snow day.
Trap that bitch.
I did that one time, though.
They have snow. They have rain to get
banged in. When I lived in Virginia, I did.
No, so couples are in the house in front of the fireplace, cooking, spending time together. Out here, the sun is always out. Everybody's always naked. Out, yeah. It's always a party, so you're always out.
And down south is more family-oriented. Here, it's like nobody wants to have kids. Kids, what?
Exactly.
Turn up,
well,
yes.
Well, I mean, you know, I kind of feel like that.
Well, maybe it's the type of guy.
It's Cali.
Yes, California.
Because I have so many gorgeous clients that are not broke, that have money, and they're not married. They're not in relationships. Because, and I even ask them, well, when's the last time you went on a date? They'd be like, what's the date?
Exactly.
What's the date?
Try ChristianMingle.com.
Downward. Was on there. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, I was about to, hang out with a guy. We're going to go on a date. And he texted me, oh, can you come get me? Say what?
Yes.
Who say who?
See?
I can't.
And he was serious, I'm sure. I would have been like, Uber, homeboy, and play it off.
Yeah.
Please.
I just didn't text her like, you know what?
Even Uber's not safe, though.
You have a car. I can't go.
You heard about the guy? Yeah.
Did you guys hear? This is, I know we're not on Hot Topics, but did you guys hear about the girl who got taken from a West Hollywood club by an Uber driver? She was drunk.
I was going to make that a Hot Topic.
Woke up in the
bed.
And what happened?
Woke up in a hotel bed.
Hotel naked.
No.
With the Uber driver.
Yeah. Right. Be careful, girls and guys. You never know.
That's lights out for Uber.
You never know.
Is there anything else that you want your fans to know about you and your fabulousness, darling?
You can follow me on Twitter at China Upshaw Hair, and my Instagram is at China Upshaw. And I will have my own show of some sort. One day.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't want just a plain, boring reality show. I have ideas for, like, a different type of show that isn't out. So it's just a matter of someone seeing my vision and believing in it.
Are you currently pitching it to any network?
I've pitched it to a production company, and they shot it down. And due to my contract, I'm not able to do anything else with it if they don't want to do anything with it.
Damn.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So I just have to sit on it until, you know. Yeah.
In God's time, girl.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
So besides that, is there any other future projects that we can expect from you?
Just waiting for my dream man to fall out of the sky, really.
Yes, Lord. Yeah. And then if he falls down, girl, if he got a cousin or a brother, even his dad, honey, just, you know what, just go ahead.
AARP, it's all right with her.
Well, thank you so much. You were such a crazy, fun interview. We love you here. Even though you was a little like, wait a minute, what's going on?
I was like, what is this? I'm rolling up in here.
Michelle, where can your fans find you?
You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Michelle Renee TV.
And Corrinne, what about you?
At Just Saying OA, because you know what?
She just saying.
And
you guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Ashley Gray TV. And check out my website, www.ashleygraytv.com. Thank you so much, and we will see you next week.
Peace.
From producers Maria Menounos, Dario Kristen, Tiana Hobson, Kevin Undergaro, and the entire BHL crew, we would like to thank you for supporting Black Hollywood Live, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African-American entertainment. For questions and comments, contact us at info@blackhollywoodlive.com. Like us on Facebook, tweet us, or Instagram us at BHL Online. And I'm your BHL announcer, Scipio. Instagram me at Planet Scipio. Thank you for tuning in.
Redefined.
Okay. The views expressed here are those of the host only and do not necessarily reflect the views of BHL or its owners or principals.
Thanks for watching Black Hollywood Live on YouTube. For more in-depth interviews and news, subscribe to our channel here and be sure to share your opinion in the comment section below here. See you soon, everyone. Bye.